fifth dimension, beyond that which is known to man. It is a dimension as vast as space and as timeless as infinity.
And this discussion about national divorce has been around for a long time.
It is the middle ground between lights.
Welcome, good sir. How are you doing? We were finishing up having some celebratory fun at calling this nonsense a year ago. And then we were actually going to get into you. Actually, no, we were going to get into you.
Also have to litigate, but the long and the short of it is we possess evidence that up until this release the Justice Department may not have. They possess evidence that we don't have, and the cumulative impact of all that evidence will hopefully lead to justice for those that have broken the law here.
Mr. Schiff, the Republicans plan to issue their own report saying that there were security failures that day and suggesting that, you know, why was the Capitol not more prepared? Why was that not a focus of this report and this investigation?
It has been a focus of our investigation, and indeed there will be material in the report that we'll be releasing later this week on that very issue, on the nature of the intelligence that agencies had, the degree to which it was shared or not shared, the degree to
I've
which
showed you all
upon
of it
or not acted upon, the coordination or lack of coordination among law enforcement. So those issues are addressed in our report.
Mr. Schiff, did the committee come across any evidence, any testimony that further corroborated Cassidy Hutchinson's testimony about a story that she had overheard about the former president lunging at a member of his Secret Service detail?
We will be releasing transcripts of witnesses whose testimony bears on the president's indignation, for lack of a better word, at not being able to accompany this mob to the Capitol, and I will let people judge when they review the transcripts who among the witnesses they give the most credibility to. I found Cassie Hutchinson's testimony to be entirely credible, and I will leave it to you to assess the other witnesses based on their transcripts.
Do you believe any of those witnesses committed perjury, of those that the committee found to be less reliable?
I certainly have questions about the veracity of some of the testimony we received, but I will leave it to the Justice Department and the public to make their own assessments.
Do you think the Justice Department should follow up on what Congressman Lofgren said about, and what you also mentioned about, witnesses potentially being offered lucrative positions and ahead of their testimony?
I think the Justice Department should weigh all of the evidence that we have provided and seek to obtain their own evidence about efforts to influence testimony before Congress and whether that crossed the line into illegality. Let me just say more broadly on the issue of our criminal referrals. Merrick Garland announced at the beginning of the Department of Justice investigation into the events of January 6th that he would follow the evidence wherever it leads, that there was one standard, one rule of law that would apply equally to everyone. That is our sense of the law as well. That is our sense of justice as well. We believe, as we indicated in our criminal referral, that Donald J. Trump, that there was evidence that he violated multiple criminal laws. If the Justice Department concurs with that assessment and with the evidence, then he should be prosecuted like any other American. No one should get a pass. And I think the day we start giving passes to presidents or former presidents or people of power or influence is the day we can say that this was the beginning of the end of our democracy. And we hope that while a criminal referral from Congress doesn't carry legal weight, in the sense the department's not obligated to follow our recommendations, we hope that the evidence we presented and the way we have identified how it meshes with the elements of these offenses will be taken very seriously by the Department of Justice. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I think the day while a criminal referral from Congress.
Follow and engage with C-SPAN on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at C-SPAN.
Oh shit, it's the same one. They're not gonna let me Wait, this was a while ago. Why do I want that? I don't want that. Fuck, I want June 9th for.
C-SPAN, proudly true to our mission for 40 plus years.
I think they're probably done this, right? All right, let's see what...
The operating one, a Sephardi shell built with Dutch support. The floor is covered in...
Absolutely the leader for this time because he was willing to do it. It was absolutely politically dangerous for Joe Biden, especially with his reputation, his own brand of being like bipartisan Joe, to come out and tell America, hey,
over the course of the last year and a half,
they're not even live. Bunch of losers. What a bunch of losers.
Has also put in place technologies like linear ground detection systems and automated surveillance towers and is increasing.
In April of 18, paramount to our republic.
Nobody yet.
Election deniers, those.
Right, we'll go back to looking how ridiculous they look.
Before, during, after, the entire lead up. You're not opposed to that investigation as well, in addition to the security.
It was at that moment Jim Jordan knew he fucked up.
Never said it was stolen, Mr. Chairman. I'll give you the same answer. Never said it was. I said we should investigate it. I said on January 6th, when the electoral votes were counted, that Joe Biden is president of the United States. And if you got a problem with that, I don't understand it. The real question is why don't you guys want to investigate what happened?
You said a lot of words just now, but unfortunately, you're still unwilling to say those five simple words. And
but hey, let me ask you a question. You brought up January 6th.
That fundamental question is, why wasn't there a proper security posture that day?
But you brought up January 6th, Mr. Chairman.
What?
You brought up January 6th, and you said we tried to overturn the results of the election by simply objecting. Here's what I know.
Let me say, I don't know.
Okay, well, I hope I get a chance to respond.
I mentioned
Bannon's name. I mentioned him very first.
You talked about inflation.
No, I did. And I said there are four batches of subpoena. The first batch, Bannon, Meadows, Patel, Scavino, first name I mentioned. Yeah. You got to go back. I'm sure the reporter can bring up the record.
Yeah, I think.
No, I oppose it because it's a part. Look, you got the two impeachment managers that you put on the committee, Adam Schiff and Jamie Raskin. You got Benny Thompson, chairman of the committee, who objected to the electors when George Bush ran. I guess the rule is only Democrats are allowed to object to accepting the electors on January 6th when we count the electors. And only the Speaker's office can answer that question. The people who should be called as witnesses are the ones who can answer the fundamental question. Why wasn't there a proper security presence and posture that day? Those are the people who need to be called. And it is obvious, based on the comments from the chairman of this committee, Chairman Thompson, that he doesn't want to do that. So the two questions need to be answered is, why wasn't there a proper security presence that day? And what are we doing to make sure this doesn't happen again? Those are the witnesses that should be called.
January 6, 2017. Guess who the first person was to object to counting the electoral college results for Mr. Trump? Guess who it was?
It was me.
It was you. Guess which state? Alabama, a state President Trump won by...
Hey, Mellon.
So you can object to Alabama on January 6, 2017, and for 4 years, you guys can go after President Trump, the Trump-Russia investigation. You can do that for 4 years. In October of 2020, Hillary Clinton said just weeks before the election, she said the 2016 election was stolen for her. So you guys can investigate that, all based on lies, for 4 years. We're not allowed to ask questions for four minutes about the 2020 election.
About the 2020 election?
We're not allowed to object to Pennsylvania, where they unconstitutionally changed their election law, but you can object to Alabama?
Because Jamie Raskin objected on January 6, 2017 to the electors from Florida. Benny Thompson objected to the electors from when George Bush won the office. So maybe they're the only ones who are allowed to. I can't object when there's unconstitutional changes made to the election law in Pennsylvania, Arizona, and others. I'm not allowed to object to that.
There's a difference. The difference being Democrats are allowed, but Republicans aren't.
Okay. You get the Jim Jordan point. You get the point with the Jim Jordan thing. You get it. You get it. Okay, wait. Oh, this is my favorite one. Hey, how's it going? I threw this fun video together. Hope you enjoy it. If you do, please subscribe to the channel, hit that bell, drop a like down below, maybe leave a comment, share this out, and help me spread the channel. Thanks, enjoy.
Submitted for your approval. One of the craziest conversations you're ever gonna see from elected officials. It's even hard to believe that these are officials elected in the United States of America, talking with somebody who claims he's a centrist. I give you Tim Pool.
There is a fifth dimension beyond that which is known to man. It is a dimension as vast as space and as timeless as infinity.
And this discussion about national divorce has been around for a long time.
It is the middle ground between light.
Welcome, good sir. How are you doing? How are you doing? We were finishing up having some celebratory fun at calling this nonsense a year ago. And then we were actually going to get into you. Actually, no, we were going to get into you. I've been watching. I've been trying to learn what's going on. Going backwards. Just trying to do some learning.
Hello, friends in the citizen zone. Nice to see you.
I did a lot of work on January 6th, and then I did stuff on Q. And as I went back, the stuff I know nothing about, like the era I know nothing about, is like that whole Cicada era. Like, I know nothing about it. So... like, I did my research for Q, going back, trying to learn a little bit more stuff, trying to get to know how the fuck we got here to all this mess. But I'm glad you're here. Welcome.
And shadow between science and superstition.
Ukraine used to be part of the Soviet Union.
And it lies between the pit of man's fears and the summit of his knowledge.
Yeah.
I think it's nice.
That's the thing. That's the thing. Like, you have to look at everything. Everything I look at, Defango, is like this. Ready? Hold on. Wait. It's like this.
What you do not smell is called iocane powder. It is odorless, tasteless, dissolves instantly in liquid, and is among the more deadly poisons.
Why is it so quiet?
Where is the poison? The battle of wits has begun. It ends when you decide and we both drink and find out who is right and who is dead.
But it's so simple. All I have to do is divine from what I know of you. Are you the sort of man who would put the poison into his own goblet or his enemies?
Welcome in, by the way. Seriously, you are welcome here. I'm glad to have you here. Conversation is the key to everything.
Now, a clever man would put the poison into his own goblet because he would know that only a great fool would reach for what he was given. I'm not a great fool, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you must have known I was not a great fool. You would have counted on it, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You've made your decision then?
Not remotely. Because Iocane comes from Australia, as everyone knows. And Australia is entirely peopled with criminals. And criminals are used to having people not trust them, as you are not trusted by me, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you.
Truly, you have a dizzying intellect.
Wait till I get going! Where was I?
Australia.
Yes, Australia. And you must have suspected I would have known the powder's origin, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You're just stalling now.
You'd like to think that, wouldn't you? You've beaten my giant, which means you're exceptionally strong. So you could have put the poison in your own goblet, trusting on your strength to save me, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you've also bested my Spaniard, which means you must have studied. And in studying, you must have learned that man is mortal. So you would have put the poison as far from yourself as possible, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You're trying to trick me into giving away something. It won't work.
It has worked. You've given everything away. I know where the poison is.
Then make your choice.
I will. And I choose. What in the world can that be?
What? Where? I don't see anything.
Oh, well, I could have sworn I saw something. No matter.
What's so funny?
I'll tell you in a minute. First, let's drink. Me from my glass and you from yours.
You guessed wrong.
You only think I guessed wrong. That's what's so funny. I switched glasses when your back was turned. Ha ha, you fool. You fell victim to one of the classic blunders.
Oh, it's just too good. But that's exactly what I feel like. But, like, I'm thorough and patient. And I'll make mistakes, but slowly, methodically work my way through whatever is knowable. You know, that's all you really have. Where were we?
Naive to believe that the United States is always going to exist in these perfect 50 states.
This is the dimension of imagination. It is an area which we call
Timcast IRL Podcast. Republican states should leave and we should leave. But what people don't understand is that's exactly what happened in the first Civil War. It wasn't like you had all of the states fighting in Congress and then all of a sudden started shooting each other. In fact, what actually happened first was several states said, "We out." And they went, "Okay, bye." So what would happen in the event of a national divorce? Sure, you know, California, Illinois, New York might be like, "We're going to Canada" or something. But then all of a sudden you're going to have one state's got a nuclear arsenal.
Well, that sure escalated fast.
And they're going to say, "We're the true government of the United States of America, and those nukes belong to us." And then one of these states, is whichever faction is in control of D.C. or whatever, they're going to say, "No, it's ours. You can't take it." And we're going to then, you know, relocate.
Right, demented?
Okay, these weapons. And that's basically what happened with Fort Sumter.
What does he think? You're just going to dig up some silos and move nuclear weapons that are scattered throughout America?
Let me give two examples of successful secession in history that everybody knows about and everybody forgets about. Mm-hmm. And one's very specific to your case. Ukraine used to be part of the Soviet Union. And they left.
What's up, Wick? We're in here just wicking out about Civil War. Wick TV. God, that looks good, Wick. Wick, that looks good. It's pretty sexy. You know what? Why don't you go for a slight color change, too? No, I'm just kidding. It your entrance popcorn and the purple, it'll be a nice coupling to get people used to the Wick TV thing. Well, I mean, if they bullied you into it, it was for your own good.
There were a lot of those
Well, I mean, the Soviet Union collapsed. So,
I mean, wouldn't the Soviet Union call it a collapse?
Now, Wick, here's what you do. Ready? Here's what you do. You said you're about $1,000 away. Promise if you raise $1,000 by the new year, you will get a Wick TV tattoo. How's that? Seems like a lot of people got an Cicada story from the FT article. Financial Times. I'll check it out. The game theory and QAnon. Well, the funny thing is, I did a little show on QAnon. Let's see if I have anything in the back end still. I don't think I deleted it.
Ron Watkins at one point was like one of the biggest, like he said, the second most powerful Twitter user on Twitter behind Donald Trump. And the reason why was he had tools that were given to him, access to tools that allowed his tweets to do things to the algorithms and to manipulate the tools to be spread to a mass.
So he helped me start going all the way back to Blood Libel. Through Anonymous, through Cicada, Gamergate, Pizzagate, the election, Q, the election, all of that. What do we got here? Wait, where'd I go?
The human mind is a tricky thing. For example, if you sit in front of a television set with just snow on, eventually, you will start to see things.
All right, Shatner, see
ya. Your brain can't deal with the idea
we'll get you
there's
later.
Nothing connected in the information you're seeing.
Q clearance, I had a Q clearance when I worked. A Q clearance is a clearance given by the Department of Energy.
What if everything you knew about the world was wrong? Because the good guys were really the bad guys. And the bad guys were way worse than you ever imagined. And what if the only people brave enough to expose this truth were a bunch of concerned military or intelligence insiders? QAnon is the online conspiracy that claims exactly that. But that narrative is almost a distraction. Taken at face value, at the heart of Q lies an effort to generate distrust. Whether it's a state-sponsored disinformation campaign or something more spontaneous is harder to say. Simplifying it, as most of the media currently does, as a far-right conspiracy that worships Trump and believes his opponents are satanic pedophiles, probably misses the point. I first came across Q last summer. The FT had invited Adam Curtis, the cult BBC documentary maker, to a one-off experimental stage show. He told the story of Operation Mindfuck, which he explained had been devised by two counterculture radicals in the 1960s. Both were practitioners of something called Discordianism, a sort of parody religion centered on the worship of the goddess of chaos, Eris. One of them, Kerry Thornley, wanted to understand how malleable reality really was. He did so by starting a conspiracy of his own in the letters pages of Playboy magazine, anonymously. The letter asked if a single secret society, the Illuminati, was really behind all the political assassinations in the world. Kerry Thornley thought this was a crazy idea that nobody would ever believe, except that over time, strange coincidences, often involving the government, kept happening to him. These eventually made him believe his own conspiracy, prompting a huge amount of self-doubt to the point he no longer knew what was real or not. Adam Curtis links that to the emergence of the dual state theory at the heart of QAnon.
What he didn't reckon with was that the fact that there really was what one State Department man called, he was called Hans Morgenthau, he called it a dual state. He said, look, if you've got a democracy, democracy has got to keep its people safe, and that means at some points it's going to have to do something very bad. But in democracies, you can't tell them that. You can do it for a dictator, but you can't do it in democracies. You've got to keep it quiet. And he, in 1955, called it, disapprovingly, he called it the dual state, which is, I think, the origin of the phrase we all now know called deep state.
QAnon's origins are remarkably similar. In 2017, the Q team, whoever they may be, made use of the modern equivalent of the Playboy's letters page. It's a message board called 4chan. They used it to bring the world dispatches about this secret dual system. A YouTuber called Defango has since claimed the work was his. He says he created Q.
This is famous. Look, he's famous.
Q is an alternative reality game, mostly for the lols, but also to smoke out bad journalists in the alternative media space. But he also says that in 2018, a man called Thomas Schoenberger wrested control of the game from him. And in a nod to Operation Mindfuck, Defango says he too is no longer sure if he ever controlled the game at all. Nobody knows if what he says is really true. What is becoming clear is that the whole thing has run away with itself. Q drops a cryptic message encouraging Q followers known as Bakers to go and solve. He tells them to do their own research. Bakers authenticate that it's really Q via the trip code used in the post. They package the information into a wider map based on so-called proofs. Coincidences matter, as do symbols. The best proof is when Donald Trump himself tweets or says something that can...
That's the thing, Defango. Like, all of this, the way I describe it visually, has been like a bowling alley, but with like the bumpers. And the bumpers are literally designed to learn you specifically as you go down the lane to make it more efficient. So by the time you get where you're going, you're exactly like everybody else. As long as you keep going, you will become that robot. You will become disconnected. But there's enough of the radically absurd mixed in with truth to allow the discrediting of it to be used to credit it, so that every time you reject it, it just grows stronger like fucking Fantasia.
Can be correlated to Q. The clues lead to the coming of the storm. The storm is the day the cabal will be eliminated. From this comes a world of Q clocks, quantum computers, and time travel theory. Yes, really. Because Donald Trump's uncle was asked to evaluate Nikola Tesla's remaining documents after he died, which really happened. And that's how he figured out how to make a time machine.
Which one? I mean, you're talking about the one where he called him a pussy? I mean, how about the one where Pence is in the garage and he says, I'm not getting in the car? Which could be kind of like saying, let's roll from 30,000 feet when we all know no cell phone works at 30,000 feet. That's okay. That's a cool story. But the clock thing's funny. Some guys made it. I mean, I'm more worried about the infrastructure of it than I am the clues to it. Like, there's a huge overlap in the infrastructure necessary to move that type of information to the right places. It overlaps in so many different things that, like, if you try to explain one thing, you seem like a maniac. But if there's a way to show one thing in 5 minutes, maybe. Or comedy is a way to get shit done.
And Q might be a messenger from the future or something like that. QAnon may be a byproduct of how today's highly bespoke information landscape operates. In a world of unlimited data, anyone can take a kernel of suspicion and run with it to confirm their own biases, with a view to amplifying them further. Add to that the easily weaponized nature of social media, from tweets and blogs to YouTube videos, and you can see how a bad actor can generate chaos and friction to sow discontent.
Wait, Defango. Were they just fucking with you right there? Or was that like, were they trying to say something?
Add to that the easily weaponized...
What kind of shit is that? Did you have a little conversation with them?
Nature of social media, from tweets and blogs to YouTube videos, and you can see how...
Why do they do that to you? Why? That's fucking rude as shit. Why did they do that? That's ignorant.
How a bad actor can generate chaos and friction to sow discontent.
I mean, about that, I would have a complaint. Like, please don't insinuate those things next to me.
Who is pushing the buttons doesn't necessarily matter. What matters are the techniques they are using. Anyone who plays live-action role-playing games known as LARPs will recognize the elements of Q.
Let's be fair. Would you expect anybody to believe 100% what you say? Like, whether you earned it or not, whether it's rightful or not, at this time, with every fucking thing that has gone on, wouldn't somebody have to be like a little... Man, what, like, you'd have to be missing something to just blanket trust anybody involved in this. Like, I think we could agree on that.
In
2015, 2016, 2017, there were a lot of what are called LARPs. Live action role playing is what the term means. And it really just means that there's a...
I mean, I think the key is, how do you move away from mutual assured destruction into something more amicable than that? I wouldn't, but during that time, your YouTube channel with countless hours of evidence. Yeah, I know. I get it. Like, the problem is, you decode it, and even though it makes total sense to you, they just have this block. Like, you've experienced it. Everybody, like, trying to get anybody to hear something, you see where that block and that disconnect goes from where they're following you, and then they've got to deviate because, like, they're done.
Person pretending to be somebody else. The players knew they weren't real, but it was fun for them to interact with. But what happened on 4chan and 8chan is that individual people would go and LARP all by themselves and create basically a single point of contact for an entire alternate reality game. In 2016, there was FBI Anon and CIA Anon and MegAnon and all of these different LARPs that were basically practiced.
Now, my theory would be that if I ran this infrastructure the way, let me run this through, and then you tell me which direction you would say I would go. So if I was running an operation like this, and I knew that I had X number of tools that were able to promote things, but I couldn't guarantee it, I would want to be able to use my percentage chance of accomplishing it and double that with the number of opportunities that I have to convert one of those that are, say, working together or being promoted through the same tools that, say, Gamergate or whatever used, that you guys used, like all those same bot tools, all those same farms, all the same human resources, like, you said you were in the election back in 08, that type of cog, you have that type of human cog. So you have all that. You have to have X number of opportunities for it to pop off. They get one of them to get more attention, and that's the one they focus on for October of, 17. And from there, they have the one from all the different LARPers that they're able to work around. And then they move it over to Bannon's old buddy Watkins that he knew back from Gamergate and shit like that. And then they now have the control they want, where the Watkins can make the posts and, like, somebody will fund Goldwater or whatever, like all that nonsense bullshit. So they had X number of opportunities. I'm sure it was a mathematical equation to ensure that it works. And they're just able to take that infrastructure that they've been building, that, you know, the same tools for Brexit, the same tools for Haiti. No, off. You would say I'm off. Just your brain. That's pretty big. That's pretty big. I would entertain that. I'm not averse to it being, with all due respect, Trump said some dude in a basement. Simple volunteer. Yeah. And then you ended up working up to, like, analytics and shit, and metacalculus, I believe was the phrase you used. And then into Cicada. Predictions. Forecasting. Based on probability with an exceptionally large amount of data points. Super forecaster. I do find it funny. I refer to it as phishing, like not phishing like the virus, but I mean, you guys know the personality traits that you needed to attract, and you utilize tools to do that. Talking about asteroids? Well, I wouldn't look up.
That we're prototyping what QAnon is.
In many ways, the connections Jim identifies echo the madness of the QAnon network maps. There are disaffected spies, there's Julian Assange, famous filmmakers, technologists and LARPers, and even secret societies and cults. But there are also links to internet mysteries like Cicada, and ideologies that link back to the libertarian philosophies expressed by the cypherpunks who brought us Bitcoin. Most concerning are connections to a possible real-life occult movement that was
That's pretty funny. That's pretty funny. I can hear your... No, with all respect, I heard your spin on it right there. Because I think in one video you said it came from two different places, but you came from that area. So I like that you gave them that came from that... I like that.
Link back to the libertarian philosophies expressed by the cypherpunks who brought us Bitcoin. Most concerning are connections to a possible real-life occult movement that was the offshoot of the theosophy theory that influenced Heinrich Himmler and the Nazis. It is another rabbit hole.
Cicada was a really interesting, legitimate internet puzzle game that a lot of people played because it involved many cool techniques, cryptography and steganography and cryptocurrency and all this really interesting stuff packaged into an investigation that you needed to do. And you had to be really smart and really good in order to even come close to it. And that was one of the appeals. So it turns out there's a guy named Thomas Schoenberger. He saw the Cicada game as an opportunity to radicalize smart people. And he ended up creating puzzles and calling it Cicada, even though he was not the creator of it.
To this day, no one seems quite sure who the creator of Cicada was. We haven't been able to confirm Thomas Schoenberger's involvement in either Cicada or QAnon.
He's currently thought of as the guru behind Cicada 3301. Cicada was this game that Thomas Schoenberger, basically the term is game-jacked from the originators, and is still running it to some extent. In the beginning, it was very much about cryptography and technology and espionage and cool and interesting topics, but in no way political, in no way harmful. What happened when Thomas got on board is that suddenly the themes turned very dark. They turned into artifacts and symbology from the occult, even Nazi symbology. One of the biggest prizes was the Spear of Destiny. It's a Christian symbol, but also used heavily by Hitler and the Nazis. And that was the final prize of a Cicada puzzle. That's the kind of thing that it started to do more and more. And the later it went, the more radical it got. And frankly, the closer to QAnon it got.
Tell us a bit more about how Cicada links into QAnon.
There's a woman named Lisa Clapier who runs an account called Snow White 7IM. And her job was to bring people from Cicada.
What's the TLDR on IM?
To QAnon. So there was a whole theme about Follow the White Rabbit, a whole theme around Snow White and Disney characters. And that theme was used specifically to pull people from Cicada into QAnon.
Jim told me these amplifier accounts are frequently endorsed by former intelligence personalities like Bill Binney and Robert David Steele to give them credibility. So if all of this is fantastical, why would they be lending support?
My name is John Cipher. I spent 28 years in the Central Intelligence Agency in the clandestine service of the intelligence agency, the espionage side of it, mostly working overseas.
I love it. Reincarnated. Wait, what? How can you believe in ascension if you believe in reincarnation? Unless I guess that reincarnated form is some sort of ascension, I guess. I guess I could see that. Anything new age?
You know, our intelligence community is huge. There's people that work in CIA and NSA, FBI, in these places. You know, some of them are intelligence collectors. Some of them are high-level analysts. But there's all kinds of people. And there's also all kinds of people who do poorly at the job and even get kicked out. So to just assume since somebody worked in the intelligence community that automatically gives them credibility, I think is a mistake. And it's actually works to their advantage of some of these crazy guys because they can say, I worked in the intelligence community. But the intelligence community obviously is quite keeps its mouth closed. It doesn't talk about these things. And so there's all no right. way for people to check whether the person was a terrible failure who worked for 1 year or whether they had a 30-year career and did really well.
Q is famously named after Q clearance, or so the community says. Is that correct? What is Q?
The Department of Energy in the United States controls our nuclear program, the nuclear weapons, and the process by which those are kept secure and built and things. And so if you're going to work on those programs, you have a Q clearance. So people with Q clearances aren't necessarily the same ones that are overseas trying to spy and collect intelligence. They're not necessarily the same ones that are in the NSA listening to electronic intercepts. It's a Department of Energy clearance related to nuclear weapons. So I don't know how Q got hooked up with this crazy talk about drinking blood and you know, pedophiles and things, because they just don't.
So you believe it was a cult recruiting tool primarily. Could be other things, but primarily. How does it fit into shadow box?
Cross.
Disinformation works best when at least 80% of the narrative is anchored to verifiable truth. It's a strategy that the intelligence world calls a limited hangout. QAnon is no different. And it's these connections to real truths, such as the Jeffrey Epstein case, that makes the conspiracy so alluring to ordinary people, especially to those genuinely and rightly concerned about state corruption, child trafficking, or worse. This is why it is important not to treat QAnon followers as crazy far-right evangelists.
When I was 19, back in 1974, I was recruited into a front group of the Moon Cult.
And is Thomas doing that with Kim.com? It's first called Troll Inc. Or not even Kim. I mean, I would think the API guy, Pecker. Hecker is probably a good part of that. You guys go back. Wow. I don't even know what that is. Ninja Video. No, I do know what Ninja Video is. I do know what Ninja Video is from a video you did, actually. You were talking about how your friends were getting arrested. Is that on the Farm podcast? Your friends were getting arrested and you were on the front line of that, was, I think, your words. Yeah, uploading, because he had mega upload. You talked about coming in with guns and shit.
And spent 2.5 years in it as a right-wing fascist fanatic leader. Then I was deprogrammed after a near-fatal van crash. And I woke up and I realized I want to understand how this could have happened to me. Mind control is absolutely real. And what we're talking about is not where you control your own mind or an ethical therapist is helping teach you how to control your own mind and your own feelings and right. such. What we're talking about is a form of what was called brainwashing, thought reform, coercive persuasion.
No, it's way easier now. It's way easier now. Your fucking algorithm is just like personal AI neuroplasticity for what you're going to be fed. And if you don't like actively work to like manipulate it, then it's telling you what you're watching.
Or undue influence. And what it is, it's using hypnosis. It's using control of sleep, privacy, information control, indoctrination of irrational fears called phobia indoctrination. It's inculcating a dissociative like disorder in people.
Well, way to fucking go then, right? Like, way to go. No, I'm just playing. I'm just playing. It's good because it dances around why Q worked. Yeah. Okay.
It's inculcating a dissociative like disorder in people's minds. With QAnon, I've watched specific recruitment documentaries. Yeah. And there are intentional hypnotic techniques being used.
Have you ever wondered why we go to war?
Yeah, of course.
Or why you never seem to be able to get out of debt?
This is
why there is poverty and division.
This is the same video we used. This was the video we used to show how they do the propaganda, to show how absolutely everything in here is done the way it's done. Fantastic.
And crime.
And without someone understanding how the mind works and understanding how to discriminate what is coming at them, especially if people are binge watching on the internet one after the next, and this is
who do you think did that? Who do you think did that, and for what benefit? Of course I do. I don't know if the link is still good. If the link's not still good, you let me know. Oh, shit. Yeah. Yeah, I do too. I do too. Or at least retired government. I don't see why it wouldn't be retired government.
The algorithms of the platforms have been absolutely devastating and nefarious in terms of radicalizing people.
So what is the wrong way to try and de-radicalize people?
The worst thing you can do with a family member or friend who gets into QAnon or one of these conspiracy cult things is to cut off contact with them. The risk of saying, oh, it's just stupid people, ignorant people, people who are weak, which they said about me when I was in the moon cult, by the way, which I was none of those. I was trained to die or kill on command as a moon member. Not everybody in QAnon is going to do anything violent, but there are people that are being singled out, I believe, especially former military officials, former police who have a weapons training. And they're being groomed to kind of like a Civil War scenario.
QAnon may be a cry for help by people desperate to believe in something more optimistic than the future that is currently carved out for them.
Stop killer.
What did they say?
Are you a baby
QAnon
killer too?
QAnon. QAnon. Yeah, well, QAnon.
A belief in something or someone that's looking out for their interests. Something that used to be the role of the government, but isn't anymore. And that's what's left out of the popular narrative portrayed by most of the media. QAnon differs from conventional conspiracies because it is focused on who's trying to save us rather than destroy us. The reason it runs into trouble is because the framework prompts justifiable anxieties about who the disaffected should blame for their troubles and how they might move to overcorrect the situation. This creates an environment rich for abuse by opportunistic demagogues whose agendas are far less egalitarian. Just like reading tea leaves, today we see what we want to see. QAnon is the most extreme case of this. Yes, there may be forces trying to exaggerate those inclinations to bring out the worst of our biases, and there's certainly a lot of circumstantial evidence pointing to strange cults and actors being involved. But it's impossible to say if they're just one group or many. Nazis or communists, CIA or GRU, inventors of the game or its opportunistic co-opters. Until we come up with something more concrete and cohesive for everyone to believe in, our desire to make sense of the madness will continue to draw false signals from the noise.
Not everybody in QAnon is going to do anything violent, but
what's up, Molly? Welcome in.
There are people that are being singled out, I believe, especially former military officials, former police who have a weapons training, and they're being groomed to kind of like a civil war scenario.
QAnon may be a cry for help by people desperate to believe in something more optimistic than the future that is currently carved out for them.
Yeah.
What did they say?
Are you a baby
QAnon
killer too?
QAnon. QAnon. Yeah, well,
QAnon. A belief in something or someone that's looking out for their interests. Something that used to be the role of the government but isn't anymore. And that's what's left out of the popular narrative portrayed by most of the media. QAnon differs from conventional conspiracies because it is focused on who's trying to save us rather than destroy us. The reason it runs into trouble is because the framework prompts justifiable anxieties about who the disaffected should blame for their troubles and how they might move to overcorrect the situation. This creates an environment rich for abuse by opportunistic demagogues whose agendas are far less egalitarian. Just like reading tea leaves, today we see what we want to see. QAnon is the most extreme case of this. Yes, there may be forces trying to exaggerate those inclinations to bring out the worst of our biases, and there's certainly a lot of circumstantial evidence pointing to strange cults and actors being involved. But it's impossible to say if they're just one group or many. Nazis or communists, CIA or GRU, inventors of the game or its opportunistic co-opters. Until we come up with something more concrete and cohesive for everyone to believe in, our desire to make sense of the madness will continue to draw false signals from the noise.
Did you do the Vice stuff too? I know I saw Vice and HBO, the End of the Storm thing. Both left me unsatisfied. I was supposed to have a chat with Nikki Wolf, but you were in the Vice stuff. I was supposed to have a chat with Nikki Wolf. I don't know if you know who that is, but the show I was doing kind of stopped being done. I still probably will try to find a way. Okay, wait.
America is sort of fragmented. They would look at us and say, your federal government got so unwieldy.
That's true.
Yeah, man, that's how it goes. That's why you only do 30-minute interviews. Which HBO guy? What's his name? Steele. Robert something Steele. That dude was something.
Overextended your Federal Reserve and your army, and you collapsed under your own weight, and now you're separate states.
This is one of the dumbest things I've ever heard.
That's true. Okay, so it's been done there, but it's also been done in the United States. There's one example, and I was born in the state that seceded that nobody talks about, and it successfully seceded, West Virginia.
Where?
West Virginia.
Where?
West Virginia.
Where?
West Virginia.
June of 1861, residents of the western counties of Virginia did not wish to secede along with the rest of the state. This section of Virginia was admitted into the Union as a state of West Virginia on June 20th, 1863.
Seceded from the Confederacy.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. But to do so, they had to split a state in half. And it's been totally accepted. We go on with life as if it's normal that a state just said, you know, we're going to separate. They didn't go back together when Virginia came back into the Union.
I think it's naive to believe that the United States is always going to exist in these perfect 50 states under the federal government that keeps expanding. And I think it's irrational for people to think that Americans are just going to sit idly by while our federal government completely becomes tyrannical and out of control, like we've watched it do over the past year.
What federal overreach? Are you talking about a testing mandate that got struck down? Or what are you even talking about?
And no one wants violence. And I'll say again, I'm completely against a civil war, even though the media tries to say I say things like that. I never do.
But I do truly believe
that if this becomes such a broken nation, and we have one party that is trying to rule over, like the Democrats are trying to rule over Republicans to the point where they are deciding what opinion we are allowed to say, whether we can get, whether we can stay on social media or we have to leave because we're spreading what they claim is misinformation.
Only the meatbag, they are sending their best. That's the problem.
Why do they insist that the government is big tech? That somehow the Democrats that control Congress are controlling big tech?
If they get to a point where they're saying, we're going to control your what you're allowed to do with your body and what you have to have injected into your body and you have no choice or say.
Isn't that what you're doing with abortion?
They're coming to the point where they're saying, this is what your children have to be taught. And parents, you have no input or say, and your children essentially belong to the state, like some people are actually saying out loud, and that's happening in the state of California and elsewhere.
But isn't that what you're doing with CRT?
When it gets to that point, you can't just accept or think that Americans are going to accept it. That is when it's okay to start saying,
freedom.
You know what? Just like in a marriage, I don't like the way you're treating me. You either have to change. I'm asking you to change, which is what Republicans should be saying to Democrats right now. Stop this behavior. You have to change. We all have to live here together. We should care about our country together. And if you're not, then we need to consider maybe we need to separate and what does that look like?
Can we just take a quick second to laugh at the fact that she's in Georgia and Biden won Georgia and then two Democrats were elected to the Senate in Georgia. So if anybody...
Right, DJ?
He's going to say, we don't like what you have to say. Isn't it her and her kind that need to leave?
Yeah. That doesn't sound like you can have a peaceful divorce. I mean, you've got a husband and a wife, and the wife's saying, I want to leave, and the husband's like, don't you dare or else. Mm. I mean, you're going to need more than just a court order. You're going to need police intervention and protections.